Hello and welcome back. This is the short primer on chapter 4 and 5 of Sustainability Climate Risk Certification. Both these chapters deal with climate negotiation from 1970s to 2020s. These are the various phases in climate negotiation. Let's study them one by one. So in 1979, World Climate Conference took place. It was a significant event because it was the very first time when discussion of climate change took place in a world forum. IPCC was formed, which was a scientific body that released reports on climate change. Brundtland Commission was set up in Germany, which released the definition of sustainable development that is continuing till this date. IPCC released the assessment report in 1990, in which they stated that developed countries need to reduce their greenhouse gas emission. They need to stabilize their greenhouse gas emission at 1990 levels. To achieve that, they have to reduce carbon dioxide by 60% and methane by 15-20%. Noordvik Declaration was signed, which stated that developed countries need to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions and also help developing countries in both adopting technology and adapting to climate change. In 1991, USSR disintegrated, which was a positive news as now all the countries could invest in climate change rather than armed state. 1992, the Rio Convention took place. Article 2 in this convention stated that human interference should be prevented within a specific time frame so that it does not threaten food system and enable sustainable development. Common but differentiated responsibilities was also discussed, which states that all countries have common responsibilities, but they are differentiated based on their contribution to greenhouse gas emissions. Thereby, developed countries were directed to reduce their greenhouse gas emission to 1990 levels by 2000. They also have to give financial assistance to developing countries. Comprehensive gas approach was finalized, in which three gases targets were finalized. These three gases were carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. Mitigation was given more priority than adaptation, which was considered as a local issue and can be resolved by provincial and local governments. The first conference of parties took place in Berlin. They released a mandate in which developed countries were told to have a legal binding. They have to reduce their greenhouse gas emission in a phased manner, that is 2005, 10 and 2020. Every successive phase needs to have aggressive targets than the preceding phase. The adoption of this legal binding mechanism was deferred till COP3 that was held in Kyoto. Activities implemented jointly was set up. This was another mechanism in which countries can voluntarily participate at GHG emission reduction in some other country. However, they won't be getting any emission credit for that. IPCC released their another report in which they stated that there is a discernible human influence on climate. Countries were divided into two parts, Annex 1, which were OECD countries, and all other countries were in non-Annex 1 countries. USSR was divided into two parts. The richer countries in USSR were called as economies in transition and they moved in Annex 1 countries. And all other countries moved into non-Annex 1 countries. But this optimism did not continue for long. Economies in transition countries did not want to finance climate mitigation in developing countries as they were having financial issues. US passed Biden-Hagel legislation, which stated that US cannot accept any further binding target until developing countries also participate meaningfully. IPCC released the assessment report. Also, they released the technology report, which was first of its kind, that discussed the kind of technology that would be transferred and the mechanism to transfer them from developed to developing countries. Kyoto Protocol happened in 1997. It was a complete failure. There was no long-term objectives. Developed countries had to reduce their greenhouse gas emission by 5.2% between the period of 2008 to 2012. They were given a leeway that they can detect carbon sink, which can be in the form of land use change or increase in forest area. these were the five mechanisms that was discussed here, but only three mechanisms are present right now: emission trading, NX1 countries can exchange emission between themselves, joint implementation. One NX1 country can have a project in another NX1 country and can take emission credit for that. Clean development mechanism. NX1 country can invest in non-NX1 country and can gain climate, can gain credit for that. But US withdrew from Kyoto Protocol, and this led to European Union in taking the center stand. IPCC released the fourth assessment report, which stated that greenhouse gas concentration had increased to 280 ppm. However, more failure took place. Emission credit market fell apart. This was due to inactive role of US, Australia and Canada for climate mitigation. Developing countries blamed developed countries and told them to follow common but differentiated responsibilities that was passed in VOO Convention. US also started producing biofuel with the help of corn. This led to food shortages and agriculture malpractices. Small groups formed out of those two groups. Small islands moved out from the non-NX group, stating that they are the most vulnerable and the non-NX countries were not doing enough to mitigate the climate. OPEC countries also broke out, as they were having fossil fuel and they don't want to be part of any climate negotiation. However, there was a glimmer of hope. Al Gore released a documentary that brought climate change into world notice. He and IPCC got Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. US, Australia and Canada were not actively pursuing their goals. However, there was subnational aggressiveness. Some provinces such as New York, California, Nova Scotia, Prince Edward Island, etc. were actively participating in climate change and helping in reduction of greenhouse gas. Clean development mechanism that was started in Kyoto Protocol has become a success. Many codes around the world were taking climate change into their consideration and deciding many cases based on that. In some countries, courts also directed government to take climate change into planning. In 2008, a session took place, but there was a glimmer of hope. Barack Obama was elected. His whole premise of election was change, and he changed US policy on climate change by enacting Clean Energy and Security Act and Clean Electricity Act. However, IPCC lost some of its credibility by data mistakes, by some data mistakes that were released to public. Also, in some leaked correspondences, there was exaggeration of data for climate change. EU became reluctant during recession phase. Some of the members of EU that were not so rich did not want to participate in climate negotiation. China had Olympics in 2008, and just before the Olympics, its Olympic village was covered in smog. This led to a public outcry, and China promised to reduce their greenhouse gas emission. In 2006, China had already overtaken greenhouse gas emission from USA. There was international pressure on China, India and Brazil, who were emerging countries, but they were in non-NX countries. They responded by giving financial aid and technological transfer to poorer countries, and in that way they shamed developed countries who were not fulfilling their responsibility. Copenhagen Accord. So this was a cartoon that was released during that time. So the last line, "My ice cream is melting fast," was a sly remark on failure of Copenhagen Agreement. Why it was a failure? There was a trust deficit between developed and developing countries. Both sides were blaming each other. Media was not playing its impartial role. Free rider problem. China, India and Brazil, since they were in NX and non-NX countries, they were not contributing financially to climate mitigation. However, they were polluting the environment considerably. In Copenhagen, I got there was just a note, there was no any adoption. They agreed that 2 degrees centigrade pollution is 2 degrees centigrade temperature rise would be a dangerous level, but it did not account it ocean absorption, which was happening at a rapid pace. More reasons for failure: there was no medium to long term goal in it. Developed countries reached measly targets for their greenhouse gas reduction, and there was a long-standing debate between developed and developing countries on how to seal this mitigation burden. This, however, Copenhagen was also a success in some way. These emerging countries took initiative and released double-digit greenhouse gas reduction targets. Also, US, India, and China had a photo opportunity in which leaders from these three countries pledged to aggressively pursue in the greenhouse gas reduction. This was the very first accord in which developing countries took active participation. A green climate fund was set up, which was of more than $100 billion that would help in mitigation and adaptation practices in developing countries. Other good news: local communities and multinational companies, they also invested in climate negotiation. Institutional investors asked for green companies. They don't want to invest in non-green companies. China had become a largest investor in renewable sector. Cost of low carbon technologies such as solar photovoltaic and wind turbines reduced drastically. And what about Paris Agreement that happened in 2015? It was a complete success, as can be seen from various media articles. It was attended by all the world leaders in the world, and that was the major reason of its success. So in the pre-planning phase, French president took an active role. He included all the people from various startup society, that is government, businesses and NGOs. Paris Agreement was helped by US and China bilateral agreement that was signed in 2014 that aggressively pursued climate change. So what did Paris Agreement stated? It stated that there's the increase of temperature should be kept below 2 degrees centigrade in the pre-industrial level. Small islands advocated for 1.5 degrees centigrade as they would submerge at 2 degrees centigrade. So it was also mentioned in Paris Agreement. However, it was just a prescription. There was no any concrete steps taken to achieve that. This was the very first agreement in which long-term emission goal was considered. Emission neutrality was to be reached between 2050 and 2100. This was in consonance with UN's goal of carbon neutrality by 2070. Countries were told to give their nationally determined contribution, and they can monitor that by following some mechanism. There would be regular submission of this contribution, NDCs. But Paris Agreement was a somewhat failure, because if all the NDCs are considered, even then, the temperature of the world would increase by 2.7 degrees centigrade. They did consider long-term emission goal, but there was no specific timetable and how to achieve it. So that was a failure for Paris Agreement. However, it was also a success, because this was the very first agreement in which skilled diplomacy happened with a bottom-up process of voluntary pledges. One of the major conflicts in climate negotiation was the distribution conflict, which was sidestepped in this event. Transparency was at the forefront of this event, and this event was also significant because they had a global goal of adaptation and mitigation. It was a carefully crafted legal structure in which it was left to government whether they want to ratify it by parliament or by executive decision. There were some legal obligations, but majority were opinions or recommendations. So what is the beyond further steps in Paris Agreement? there was a facilitative dialogue that took place in 2018 between all the countries. Global stocktake, that is the very first review of Paris Agreement, would take place in 2025, and it would take place after every 5 years thereafter. Critical review of Paris Agreement. So this was the very first agreement in which bottom up targets plus top down monitoring was considered. Integrated reporting system was developed by UN and that was adopted by all countries. However, no rules for manual monitoring, reporting and verification was mentioned. Paris Agreement would be successful when there would be review after 5 years and there would be naming and shaming of those countries who did not fulfill the targets. This naming and shaming would only be successful if the particular government is sensitive to international pressure. Also, if the number of countries are more that have not followed it, then peer pressure won't work. There were other players in climate change, non-state actors such as World Resources Institute and Climate Action Taker. There were quasi monitoring bodies in climate policies. There were civil societies as well, but they had domestic political pressure as well as financial issues. Companies were actively participating in climate change. They were spending on R&D, innovating, as well as investing on low carbon technologies. So what has been the review of this negotiation of 30 years from 1990 to 2020? Paris Agreement was the major breakthrough in climate negotiation. Distribution conflict, which used to happen, has been replaced by bottom-up voluntary mitigation. Soft reciprocity. Leading states created ambitious targets and encouraged others to reciprocate by raising their targets as well. But the success of Paris Agreement would be based on these three criteria. Political leadership needs to be strong. Developed countries need to give financial assistance to developing countries. And how much moral suasion would work needs to be seen. However, few bad apples can create havoc. Even one or two countries can increase the temperature of the world by 1 or 2 degrees, which can create havoc. But Paris is just the beginning. There are long-term goals that needs to be studied and that would be discussed in upcoming agreements. So this was the review of 30 years of climate negotiation. I hope you enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel. Hit the bell icon. Like, share and comment. And we will meet soon.